Chapter 16. State Your Name. As they started walking up the road, Latia couldn't get her mind to settle down. It was filled with confusion and anxiety and much more, and all she wanted was for all of it to just go away. Latia, I swear, guys, all I want to do right now is take a hot bath. If only they had such luxuries here. But let's just get rooms, order some dinner, and relax all evening, because I'm at my wit's end right now. My mind just won't stop racing. Nightwind, well, I say we turn around and go back down to the road and head east. Latia, shocked at what she just heard, turned to Nightwind. What? Are you crazy? Why in the world do you want to do that, after everything that's happened today? Nightwind, precisely because of everything that's happened today. Let's just go there and see what all the danger is about. Shinfia, Nightwind, that sounds like a really good idea. Let's just go for it. Teneth, I agree with the dwarf. I want to find some orcs and bash their heads in with my mace. Latia was now getting aggravated. Okay, what the hell is going on right now with all of you? Yet as she said those words, strange thoughts entered her mind that seemed to suggest to her that going down the east road was their best option. But then Lightmane spoke up. I must admit that those thoughts just now also entered my mind, but despite that, I agree with Latia. Going there now, with very little information about what we'd be walking into, seems reckless at best, suicidal at worst. Latia, thank you, Lightmane, the voice of reason, though I'll admit that those same thoughts just now entered my mind as well, which makes absolutely no sense to me, but seeing how my thoughts have been today. Latia just stopped speaking at that point. Jack, well, those thoughts are in my head too, but I'm kind of in the middle on all this. Not really sure what's the best option. Part of me really just wants to go, but another part is screaming, are you insane? Phileas, I thought only I was having those thoughts and wasn't going to say a word. I kind of feel the same way Jack feels, kind of in the middle. So whatever we decide, I'll go along with. Jack, me too. Everyone then looked at the halfling. Belfin, feeling nervous. Why are you all looking at me? Oh, because I haven't said anything yet. Right. Well, I'm having the same thoughts and kind of want to go too. At this point, Latia was ready to start screaming. But I have to agree with Latia and Lightmane. As much as I just want to go down that road and see what's there, my gut is telling me to walk up to the keep first. Someone a while back told me once that following my gut is usually the best course of action. Nightwind, well, my gut is telling me we should throw caution to the wind and go down that east road. Shinfia and Teneth again both agreed. Jack, so we appear to be at a crossroad. Jack's comment rolled some eyes. Sorry, bad pun. But we are, actually, for three of us want to go east, three of us want to go north, and two of us aren't certain. So I think that puts Phileas and I as the decision makers of this decision. Jack thought to himself for a moment. Well, despite how tempted I am to just give in and go, I'm going to vote we go to the keep instead. Everybody immediately looked at Phileas. Phileas, oh great, so if I vote with Jack, we go to the keep, but if I vote with the others, it's a draw? Sighing, well, I don't want a draw. I want to resolve this, so even though I was going to vote that we go down that east road, we're going to the keep. And with that, Phileas turned around and started walking up the rocky path, but the other three immediately walked after him and tried to change his mind, almost acting desperate. But Latia and Lightmane stopped them. Lightmane, hey, the decision's been made. Besides, aren't you all a little concerned that every one of us felt a pull to want to go there? Even Latia and I felt it. Doesn't that concern any of you? Nightwing, no. It tells me you're not listening to your gut, despite what the Hobbit just said. Your gut will always guide you. Latia, now really upset. And what makes you so certain that it's your gut that's telling you to take this reckless action? Because you're a dwarf? Are all dwarves reckless, or is it just you? Nightwing, angry now. If you'd like to see how reckless I can be, just come at me, half-elf, and I'll show you. At that, Latia cast her earthbow spell and drew her longsword. Ready when you are. Nightwing drew his axe and started to move towards her, but Lightmane and Shinfia moved in between them, Lightmane blocking Nightwing's path. What do you think you're doing? Put your weapon down and apologize right now. Shinfia to Latia. Latia, what are you doing? Stop this. All of a sudden, Nightwing, Shinfia, Phileas, Belphin, and Teneth all collapsed. Latia, shocked at what she just saw. What just happened? Jack, sounding irritated. I cast sleep. That's what happened. Latia, looking confused. Why? And why on just them and not Lightmane and I? What are you doing, Jack? Jack, now a little ticked off. Trying to keep my friends from killing each other. That's what, Latia. And I didn't cast it on just them. Sleep affects a random number of people. I can't control that. Also, elves are very resistant to sleep, and you half-elves are pretty resistant to it, too. But I'm sure you already knew that, since you're a half-elf, right? He said, sounding impatient now. Lightmane, great idea, Jack. Thank you. Now I'm starting to wonder if some dark magic is involved here that is messing with our minds. Latia, it's not that. It's everything that we just went through. I can't make sense of anything right now. That's why we need to eat. Relax and then sleep, but all that the dwarf and the other two want to do is go wandering off when it'll be dark soon. That's insane, and yet part of me still wants to do it too. Latia dropped to her knees, grabbing her head. Lightmane came over and got down on his knees and held her. She wrapped her arms around him tightly and started to cry. Latia, I don't know what to do anymore. A little while ago, I was just sad and crying over a female goblin who herself was sad that she couldn't come with us, and now I was ready to attack Nightwing. Please, let's just stop and go to the keep before it gets dark. As the others woke up, Jack let them know what happened and that they all needed to calm down and let's just go to the keep now. Oddly enough, they all agreed without any arguing and started walking up the road. Jack, okay, well, that was easy, he said, sounding a little surprised. The five that fell asleep all said how the urge that they felt to go down the east road was gone. Jack, Lightmane, and Latia, however, still felt that urge in their mind, which now only concerned them more. The road wound back and forth with a cliff face on either side of the road. The road was maybe 30 feet wide, but the further they walked, the higher they went, and the edge of the road looked more and more dangerous the further they climbed. Combat on this road would be extremely dangerous now, since falling off would drop you to your death now, for sure. About halfway up, there was a small drop-off on either side of the road, maybe 5 to 6 feet down, and the area below was maybe 10 feet wide on each side. The terrain there was rocky and treacherous, but you could jump down there and rest, maybe, Lightmane said out loud. Latia, or you could hide down there and attack people as they came down the road, maybe? Lightmane, looking again. Yes, but why would you? For one, you'd be at a disadvantage on lower ground, and for another, climbing back up would take a little time. I don't believe trying to ambush people here is a great idea, but I guess if you were running and needed to hide, maybe? Of course, we might not see missiles coming at us from there, or spells for that matter. I wonder if anyone's ever used this little section for anything like that. The road quickly went back to a sheer cliff face, and soon they were near the top. They were walking north, coming right at the front of the keep, but the road then turned to the right and went around to the east side, where the main gate was. They could see several guards in each of the keep's towers on the south wall as they approached. As they were walking towards the east side, guards in the high tower above stared down at them, appearing to be watching them carefully. As they came around, they saw running along the east wall was a very large and deep crevice. The road up ahead would turn left and go right up to that crevice, which continued to cut through the rocky surface for maybe 100 feet north beyond the road, and then went down the cliff, making it virtually impossible to walk around the outside of the keep, unless you could somehow get across the crevice. Where the road reached the crevice, a gatehouse, flanked by 2 30-foot-high towers with battlements, stood. A drawbridge was up. Lowering it would allow easy access into the keep. With it up, though, the party couldn't see how anyone could get inside. Now they understood what the merchant in the caravan meant when he said, "It's a fortress that's almost impossible to destroy." There were just no good places to mount an attack against it. The high, rocky cliff face all around provided the perfect protection. As they came up the road towards the main gate, 4 guards in both towers looked down at them, crossbows loaded and aimed, ready to fire. "Tenneth, let me try handling this, guys. Please do not fire on us. We are a party of adventurers from the village of Duran. We have traveled here, responding to your bulletin about the attacks on your east road. We're here to help. I am a cleric of Alana, goddess of the forests, and these are all my loyal friends and fellow adventurers. May we enter?" A guard called down. "The cost to enter the keep is 1 silver piece each. Also, you will need to report in, and we will take your name, occupation, age, and place of birth. Without all 4 pieces of information, you will not be allowed to enter. Do all of you accept all of these terms?" Nightwind, speaking to the party. "1 silver piece each, just to walk inside? My lord." Shinfia, "Our name I can understand. But age and occupation? And place of birth? Controlling bunch, aren't they?" she said, shaking her head. Tenneth called out again. "We do." Guard, "Very well. Stand back, and we will lower the drawbridge. But if any of you take any aggressive action, the 8 guards above, and many more, will fire down on you, and the drawbridge will be raised back up, forever cutting you off from the safety and security of this keep. You've been warned." The drawbridge was lowered, and 2 young men came out to them. They looked to be in their 20s. They were just under 6 feet in height and were clad in plate mail and carrying a polearm with a sword sheathed at their side. They told everyone to sheathe any and all weapons and to follow them. They brought them into the entry yard, which was a long 20-foot-wide passage running north and south, where 2 more men were waiting for them. One was at least 6 feet tall and looked maybe 30 years old. He was also clad in plate mail, but also had a large shield with a sword and dagger at his waist. The other was older, in his 40s, and shorter and thinner, wearing a robe. Jaren, "Greetings. Welcome to the keep. My name is Jaren. I am the corporal of the watch. This is our scribe, Thomas. He will check you all in. The rules here are simple and obvious. Don't cause any trouble of any kind and never draw your weapon. Anyone drawing a weapon for any reason will be arrested and jailed immediately. No questions asked. Do I make myself clear, or do any of you need a second explanation?" Tenneth, "We're good. Thank you, corporal." Jaren seemed satisfied with Tenneth's proper response of calling him corporal, and said to Thomas, "They're all yours." And then he moved off to the side, continuing to watch them, but saying nothing. Thomas, speaking to Tenneth, "State your name." "Tenneth." "Just Tenneth? Do you require more?" "Occupation?" "Cleric of Alana, goddess of..." "Yes, you already said that." "Age?" 29. "Place of birth?" "The village of Knollwood. But why do you require our place of birth, if you don't mind me asking?" Jaren addressed Tenneth's question. "The way things are going around here, I wouldn't be surprised if the Castellan adds more questions. But it's in your best interest that we have this information on you." Tenneth, "The Castellan. I take it he is the lord of this keep." Jaren, "He is the Castellan of this keep. Lord is not a title that he has yet acquired, But to finish answering your question as to why we require your place of birth and why I said it's in your best interest, suppose that you were to die here. Immediately upon hearing the word die, everyone looked up at Jaren with their full attention. Or be jailed, or go missing, or something similar. The Castellan, because he is a good and just man, would send a message to the village of your birth so that any there who knew you would know what had happened to you. Tenneth, surprised by what he just heard. Oh, I see. I hadn't even considered such. The Castellan is a very wise man. Thank you for telling us this. Jaren, looking at Latia and Shinfia. Could I interest either or both of you beautiful ladies in having a drink with me later this evening? On me, of course, he said with a smirk on his face. Latia and Shinfia looked at each other a little nervously. Shinfia, well, that's very kind of you, sir. If we are there this evening and see you, she looked at Latia once more for confirmation, that would be fine. Jaren, now with a big smile on his face, well now, this day is looking up. Carry on, Thomas. And he went inside one of the towers and closed the door behind him. Latia, whispering in Shinfia's ear, causing her to laugh, I think someone is going to go take a bath now. Everyone checked in and paid the expensive entrance fee. Thomas then told them where the inn and tavern were located. Tenneth also asked where the temple was located and was elated when he heard that it was a temple of Alana, but also to the god Hieronius, partly because most men here worshipped Hieronius and also because it was commonly believed that both were friends and allies with each other. So the dual temple seemed to work well for all. The inn had private rooms for one silver piece per night per person, or they could all sleep in a common room for 3 copper pieces per night per person. But that meant having to share the room with others. Fortunately, the inn currently had 4 private rooms available. So the girls took one, Belphin and Phileas took one, Jack and Tenneth decided to take one, leaving Lightmane and Nightwind. Nightwind, me? Sleep in a room alone? With an elf? I'd rather die. Lightmane, staring blankly at him. I can arrange that. Nightwind said nothing and just stared back. But everyone knew them too well now, so no one was falling for it. Nightwind busted out laughing anyway. Lightmane allowed a small smile to form on his lips. The inn was called the Inn of the Lonely Minotaur. When the party asked the innkeeper why it was named thus, he said that according to legend, a minotaur has lived in the woods here alone for a very long time now. They say that he hunts every night and can sometimes be heard howling in the middle of the night. It is said that if you hear him howl, it means that he's celebrating, letting you know that he has successfully captured another creature and will eat well later that night. It is also said that the other reason he howls is to let you know how lucky you are, for now you won't be his next meal this night. Latia, speaking to the innkeeper, oh my, that's quite a story. Thank you for telling it to us. But she said to everyone else as they headed down to the tavern for dinner, well, I bet all the children here just love going to sleep at night. Shinfia, I was just wondering the same thing, Latia. That's quite a legend. So whenever a wolf howls, children must shiver. The whole place looked somewhat similar to the inn and tavern in Duran, and they all sat down and ordered dinner. Shinfia, so Tenneth, what made you decide to be our spokesman today? Not that I'm complaining. You did a wonderful job. Very impressive. Tenneth, why, thank you, dear. I just wanted to try it out, to see how it felt. Also, being a cleric, I was hopeful that they would be more trusting of me. Not that they wouldn't trust you. Tenneth now sounded a little awkward and nervous. Shinfia, don't worry, dear. We know what you meant, she said, with a nice smile on her face. And that made Tenneth smile back and relax a little. As they sat and had dinner, they looked around at others to see if any looked like they might want to talk to them, see what they could learn about the goings-on around here, let alone outside. The place was quite busy, but no one seemed to show any interest in them at the moment. Oddly enough, the sexy-looking serving wench, Kim, provided them with some information. You're just the second party to show up here recently. Another showed up a couple days ago. Shinfia, really? Just one? We heard at least three adventuring parties had headed out from our village before we did. How could we have gotten here before them? Kim, maybe you didn't. Maybe they're dead. Everyone felt a chill go up their spine when they heard Kim say the word dead. But then she continued, or maybe they didn't come here and just went adventuring. When Kim said that, everyone thought about how they almost just went adventuring tonight too, instead of coming here. Latia, guys, are you all thinking what I'm thinking? Lightmane, what, that maybe another party did what we almost did? Sure, it's possible. Nothing we can do about it, though. If they did, here's hoping they're okay, and we meet them soon. Shinfia, speaking to Latia. Hey, if that Jaren guy shows up tonight, which I'm certain he will, Latia, to have a drink with two women, yeah, I'd say the odds are, 100%? Shinfia, smiling. Hence why I was about to say to you, say that you and I should try to see if we can get some information out of him. See what he knows and stuff. I think if we don't hear much tonight, we should walk around this place in the morning and meet some people before heading down the East Road. Agreed? Everyone agreed. Jack, while everyone was eating. Hey, ever since we checked in here, I've been meaning to ask you all something. All of your names seem so interesting to me. Most humans have names like Jack or Carl, Laura. Nothing wrong with them, obviously, but yours all seem more interesting. I wonder what causes parents to choose the name they do for their child. My mother told me she named me Jack because she thought she just liked the name. Thought it was a good name for a man. Tanith. Well, my older brother's name is Tanith, and my older sister's name is Tanitha. My father's is Thomas, and my mother's is Tina. Clearly, they wanted all their children to have a name that began with the letter T. I guess they also liked all of their children having similar-sounding names. Jack. Tanith, Tanith, and Tanitha. Yeah, otherwise they might have named you Tim. Tanith. Tim? He said, sounding a little confused. Oh, I see. Tim, Jack, Carl. Sure. Well, just don't call me Ten, he said, smiling back. Jack. Huh? Oh, Tanith, Ten. Oh yeah, that doesn't really work now, does it? Speaking of shortened names, how about you, Shin? Shinfia, enjoying why Jack chose her next. Well, my mom's name is Shinfia Leia. Latia, Shinfia Leia. Oh, I love that name. It's beautiful. Shinfia, I know, isn't it? I love it too. Everyone, though, usually just called her Shinfia. So she named me Shinfia. She won't admit it, but I'm sure she did that because she wanted others to call her Shinfia Leia. But most people usually just call me Shin, she said, laughing a little. But I don't mind. I like both names. But my mom's name is the prettiest. Latia, Shin, I love that. Well, Latia is the name of my elven father's great-grandmother. Apparently all of my elven family's names get recycled eventually, she said, laughing, and the others laughed too. Belfin, who was also smiling now, spoke next. My parents named me Belfin because when I was born, my mother was on a boat in the ocean, and she saw a dolphin, and someone on the boat rang a bell. Everyone looked at Belfin quite awkwardly, not quite sure what to say. Belfin, I'm kidding. That was a joke. Jack, laughing. Oh, hobbit humor. Okay, now it's funny. And everyone started laughing. Belfin. Belfin is just a typical halfling name. Delfin, Durnin, lots of inns in halfling names. Phileas, oh come on, there's lots of halflings that don't have an inn in their name, right? Belfin. Well, yes, that's true. It's just a typical halfling name, like Jack is a typical human name. Jack. Ah, okay then. Phileas? Phileas, wanting everyone to understand. Well, mine isn't a joke. Gnomes love having similar-sounding names in their family, at least in my family. Every one of my brothers and sisters' names ends in Ilias. Jack. No way. Really? Phileas. Gilius, Gilius, Dilius, Bilius, and Lilius. Jack, trying not to laugh. Why do I feel like that sounds like something gnomes would do? Phileas, because it kinda is. I believe they only stopped having kids because of the names that were left. Jack, huh? Jack started going through the letters in his head. Oh, Kilius. Now there's a name that no one wants. Oh wait, Pilius and Silius. Yeah, I see what you mean. Everybody started laughing. Nightwind spoke next. I was named Nightwind because I was born on a very windy night outside. Everyone wondered if that was a joke too, but Nightwind was serious. Nope, not a joke. That's what happened. She felt she had no choice but to call me Nightwind. She believed it was my destiny. Jack, huh. That's interesting. It's really interesting how names are sometimes chosen. Everyone then slowly started looking over towards Lightmane. Jack, so that just leaves you, Lightmane. I've always been most curious about your name, so I just have to ask. Why did your parents name you Lightmane? Lightmane, well, you might not believe it, but I'm not joking either, just so you know. He took a moment and then continued. I was born with a very thick head of golden hair that went from ear to ear. When my mother first held me, she lifted me up high and said how I looked like a baby lion with my cute golden mane. And right at that moment, the morning sunlight shined through a stained glass window right on top of my head. And when she saw how my golden hair glistened in the sunlight with its many colors from the stained glass, she said she knew right then and there that my name was Lightmane. Everyone kind of just sat there, almost in awe, not quite sure how to react to Lightmane's story. But then Jack spoke up. Jack, well, in case there was any doubt, the winner of our baby naming contest is Lightmane. Bale, I just want to thank you again for making this marvelous magical contraption that you made that allows me to eat food almost like a normal person instead of licking it out of a bowl like a dog. Your many skills never cease to amaze me. Sheila, why thank you, and you're welcome. I do enjoy making things, especially when they help others. Bale, well then, I've been thinking recently how much I miss writing and how I wish I could write again. Sheila, you miss writing? Do you want to write a book? Bale, oh, he said, thinking for a moment. Well, that's an interesting idea. I might like to do that too sometime. But what I really want to do, now that I'm not going adventuring anymore, is make a whole bunch of magic scrolls. It would be nice to build up a collection. Sheila, have I still not shown you my room where I keep all my scrolls and wizard stuff? Bale's eyes lit up and his tongue came out of his mouth. Why, no, you haven't. May I see it? Sheila, why, of course you can, my good friend. Follow me. Bale was now filled with anticipation as he followed her. Sheila took him down the main hall, and then down another hall, and then through a door that he never saw until she opened it. It led to a spiral staircase that went down and ended in a wall. Sheila touched the wall, and it slid open. Inside was a huge room that was, in every way, a wizard's laboratory. Many tables with potions and spell books and all kinds of items were everywhere. He had never seen so much wizard stuff in all his life. Bale, feeling like a kid in a candy store now. Well, if I didn't die and go to heaven before, I sure did now. I guess you waited a bit to show me all this because you didn't want to overwhelm me? Sheila, yeah, kinda. Bale, looking at all the scrolls on the table. So these are your scrolls. Impressive. Sheila, oh, these are just a few extras. I keep all my scrolls around the corner. Follow me. She walked into an adjacent room that was filled with hundreds of scrolls all along the walls, like books on bookshelves, with a very large and beautifully ornate table in the middle of the room that had over a dozen chairs all around it. Both the table and chairs were colored green and brown with yellow swirls throughout. The back wall had books on bookshelves, beautiful looking books. The whole room captivated Bale as he stood there, looking around in awe at everything. Bale, so this is heaven, he said, looking more excited than he had ever looked. Sheila, smiling, held out her hands wide. Welcome to my heaven, turning to an item on the table and pointing to it. Now here's something I think you'll really like. Bale looked and saw a beautiful, small, rectangular-shaped metal box. It was ornately decorated and made of the same three colors that the table and chairs were. Sheila pulled out a chair. Have a seat, Bale sat down. Now, open the box. Inside was a very beautiful quill with an inkwell. They were also colored in the same three colors. Bale looked so excited when he saw it, but then looked sad, since he had paws now and not hands, so he couldn't write with it. Sheila, now, my floppy-eared friend, there's no reason for you to be sad. Did you really think I'd bring you down here to show it to you if you couldn't use it? Bale, looking excited again, but very confused. No, you wouldn't. But how can I possibly write anything with these paws? I don't see how any contraption like you made for me for eating could possibly work for writing. Sheila, you're right. No magical contraption of any kind could help you write with those paws. Obviously, she said with her typical smirk. Bale, having often seen this look on her face before, okay, I'm ready. Show me what you got. Sheila pulled up a chair and sat next to him, and then pointed to a scroll that was on the table. Open it. Bale struggled a bit, but he finally got one of his paws to hold down one end of the scroll. What spell or spells are on this scroll? Sheila, just open it. He unrolled the scroll partway with his other paw, but so far it was blank. He looked at Sheila again. Sheila, sighing. Open it all the way, silly. As he did, magical energy started to swirl all around the open ornate box. The quill seemed to come to life and rose up in the air and put itself in the inkwell, and then rose back up and floated over the scroll. Bale's eyes lit up. What do I do now? The quill started writing. What do I do now? Bale gasped. The quill wrote again. Gasp. Bale. Sheila, what's going on? Sheila, what's going on? Sheila, it's okay. Just relax. This quill will write what you say, and even what you think, if you want it to. Don't worry, it won't write out your thoughts unless you want it to. And once you learn how to control it, which you will with practice, it will only write what you want it to write, meaning you can think and talk all you want and it won't write a thing. The quill needs to learn how your brain works, just as you need to learn how it works. It's like being in a symbiotic relationship with it. This scroll and others on this table can all be used to practice on, and these scrolls over here are the ones you'll use to practice copying. This might confuse you, but I'll try my best to explain how I've done this. This wall of scrolls is like my spell book. It contains every spell, but only one spell is on each scroll. The reason for this is when someone wants to copy a spell, or practice, or whatever, they find the spell that they want. The other wall is my actual collection of scrolls. Each of them have 7 spells on them. Don't touch those scrolls with 7 spells on them. I hope that was clear enough. Have fun, she said in her typical whimsical way. With that, she got up and started walking towards the other room. Bale, wait, where are you going? Sheila, I have some things that require my attention, as I'm sure you understand, and you have a room full of new toys for you to play with. Just be careful and relax, and everything will be fine. If you need me, just close your eyes and talk to me like you have before, but only if you really need me, okay? Bale, okay. Wow, I'm really overwhelmed. I don't know how to thank you. Sheila, well, you just did, she said, smiling. Bale smiled back. She turned to leave again, and then turned right back around. Sheila, oh yes, one last thing. She then pointed to the scrolls on the walls. All of my single spell scrolls are categorized in alphabetical order and also by spell level, 1 through 9, so don't mix any of them up. When it comes to my scrolls, I'm extremely organized, so only take out one at a time and don't take out another until you put it back where you took it from. Do not mess up my order. Got it? Bale, got it. Don't worry. I'll take great care of everything here. Wow, ninth level spells? I've never seen a ninth level spell before. Wait, I can try copying ninth level spells? I'm scared to touch them. Sheila, don't be. They won't bite, she said with a smile. And with that, she turned around and left, leaving Bale alone in her laboratory. Bale looked around, and then looked around some more, and then looked around some more. So, this is heaven. Thank you.